God. Thank you, worship team. Amen. Without any further ado, let's turn to the book of Hebrews in the New Testament, chapter 6. This is graduation weekend, and boy, didn't we have a crew of graduates, and we had a lot that were missing, and how many we have, 11, 12, a dozen graduates this year between high school and college. That's not bad. Amen. They're moving on to a new stage in life, but you know, in our Christian walk, how many know that we are also learning? And we are moving forward. The Bible says line upon line, precept upon precept, we go from glory to glory. How many know if we stay in the same location, over time we stagnate, we die. Amen? As Christians, we need to be ever learning, but we don't need to be like those who are ever learning and never coming to the knowledge. Amen? We need to be those who learn and come to a knowledge and an understanding that we can apply in our lives and use it for the glory of God and the benefit of mankind. Amen? So I want to turn this morning in a very practical sense. This is not the type of message I would normally preach. This is going to be more informational and instructional, but I believe it'll be transformational as well. Amen? I pray that I give you more than facts today. I pray that I give you a revelation of what God wants revealed. Things we need to know as Christians, things that we need to understand. Amen? Verses 1 through 3 of Hebrews chapter number 6. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, of the doctrine of baptisms and of laying on of hands and of resurrection of the dead and of the eternal judgment. And this will we do if God permit. Father, we need the divine enablement and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, God, enable in order, rather, to communicate this glorious gospel message in a manner that it would produce fruit that remains in the life of the listener and in the heart of the hearer. And so, God, I ask this morning that, Lord, as we begin to deliver a word in due season, that it would become not only logos, but rhema. I pray, God, through it all, there would be a revelation of truth that would change somebody's life, for you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. I pray that, God, today, that if there's somebody that has had questions, today they'd find the answer. God, I pray, Lord, that in everything that is uttered from this pulpit and these lips of clay, that it would bring honor to the God who speaks the message to the heart of mankind. Lord, today thy will is what we desire more than anything else. And God, we want nothing less than God to be glorified and Jesus to be exalted and man to be changed and conformed into the image of Christ. Elevate us and grow us and build us and strengthen us and establish us. Lord, help us to begin to graduate and move on to higher learning in the things of the Spirit. God, I pray, Lord, that we would not, Lord, flunk out and fail the test of life, but I pray, God, that we would succeed and we would, Lord, move on with commencement, which not only means an ending of one, but it means a beginning of another. And I pray, Lord, we would move past what we should have learned and grab a hold of what we need to learn. And I pray, God, today that you would take us to the next level, move us to the new arena. God, I pray, Lord, that you would begin to do something in us you have never done before. And I pray, God, we would never again be the same. I pray today you would transform us by the renewing of our mind. God, get into our heads so you can get into our heart. And God, today, let there be a change in every one of us. I pray and ask it in Jesus' name. And for your glory, Lord, alone I ask it. Amen. Lord, well, it's graduation weekend. And graduation is considered a landmark in the process of maturing and growing up. You graduates have just hit one of the pinnacles of your life. You have just reached one of those landmark moments that you will always remember. High school graduation, college graduation, marriage, promotion, jobs, those things come into play. We look back at our life, they all make a difference. But we as Christians, not just as individuals and people, but we as Christians also need to be in the process of maturing and growing spiritually, one of the things that really breaks my heart and one of the areas that I really try to put emphasis on is Christians who have never matured in Christ. They are the same today as they were the day they accepted the Lord. They've not grown, they've not learned, they've not matured. We've talked a lot lately about the level of maturity of people who call themselves Christians. We've talked about the infant stage where when a baby doesn't get their way, they throw a temper tantrum. And how many Christians, when they don't get their way, they throw a fit? They start complaining about the church, the preacher, the time, the location, the whatever they can find to complain about. They just start having a hissy fit, temper tantrum. And then when they become a teenager, when they become an adolescent, they no longer throw the hissy fit like the child does, but now they, if I don't get my way, I'm going to take my bat and ball and go home. You play my way or I hit the highway. It's my way or no way. Amen? That's immaturity. That's still in the process of growing up. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought as a child. I understood as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. And there are times in our life where we are young. And I've shared before about a message I heard in Bible school that stuck with me all these years about IT, it, in transition. And the speaker that day talked about two apples. He talked about a red apple and a green apple. And he said to us, he said, the green apple is just as perfect as the red apple. It's just in a different stage of development. Sometimes we are in different stages of development. There's nothing wrong with being a green apple or a green Christian if you are young in the Lord. But if you've been in the Lord a while and you're not turning a little bit red, there is a little problem.
Come on.
Amen? You see, I understand that some are not on the same level of others, but I want to tell you, when you've been serving God for a few years and you're still acting like you did when you first got saved, there is an issue that needs to be confronted. There is a problem that needs to be deliberated. There's action that needs to be taken, and there is some change that needs to come. Amen?
Amen?
We should be in the process of maturing and growing up spiritually, but Paul did address those that should be teachers, but they themselves still needed to be taught. I hope you're not in that category. I hope that your behavior reflects more of Christ than sometimes, we let it. Amen? Because if we're grown up, we need to act grown up. There are a lot of people I see that know it here, but don't apply it in their hands and their feet and their mouth and their...
Tell it.
Come on now, church. Amen or out? It's the truth. Some of us don't act grown up in the things of God. We have all the theology you want to get, and a lot of churches fill your head with theology, but they have no emphasis on application or experience. I want to tell you, let me tell you, they used to say, if you're happy, notify your face. Let me tell you, if you're mature, act like a grown up. No more temper tantrums, no more throwing fists, no more letting everybody else do the job because you don't want to take the responsibility. Because, see, that's the difference. I asked the question of the renovation house, and I shared this on Father's Day. How many men are in the house? Because being a male doesn't make you a man. You can be a boy and be a male. So how many grown-ups are in the house? And then there's a difference not only between being a man and a male, there's a difference between being a man of God and a man. How many of us are men and women of God and not just men and women? And how many of us are not even men and women? Because the difference between a man and a boy is the level of responsibility they'll assume.
I have most of it done.
I know some teenage boys that are more manly than some men. They take responsibility more than the man does. And here it is, guys. If you really are growing up in the things of God, if you're graduating, you are expected to begin to take on some new responsibility. And in the church, as we mature, and what is the purpose of the pastor, the evangelist, the apostle, the prophet, and the teacher? It's trying to get people to mature and grow up, and so they're not tossed about. My responsibility is as an instructor or as a teacher or as an example to get you to grow up in the things of God. Amen? And one of the things that saddens my heart is and I feel sometimes like a failure is when I pour my heart and life out into trying to get people to grow and still see infantile behavior. Ouch. Backbiting, fighting, tearing each other apart. That's not maturity. That's infancy. Start nitpicking the other person and start pointing fingers elsewhere instead of pointing inward. When you start pointing outward and not inward, you have not reached the mature process. A mature individual learns from his mistakes. He looks inside, takes inventory, and said, Lord, change me. That's where real growth is evidence. You can't say, change me, if you haven't reached the mature level of understanding that none of us are perfect yet. The first step in becoming a spiritual graduate is understanding that we haven't arrived. Commencement doesn't just mean end, it means beginning. It means the end of the old but the beginning of the new. You graduates that are graduating high school and college, it's not over. You've only just begun.
Amen.
Before a graduate, however, receives the diploma, they have to meet certain educational requirements. In New York State, 22 units are required for graduation. They need 4 units, and that's a unit is a year's worth of study. They need 4 units of English, 3 units of math, 4 units of social studies, 3 units of science, 2.5 units of physical education, 1 unit of arts, 1 unit of foreign language, and there's a few others thrown in there, but all together, in order for a young person to graduate from a New York State high school, they have to have 22 units completed. I want you to understand that there are certain things they must know, and there are certain foundational truths that will prepare them for college or career and life in general. And the scripture reveals there are 6 foundational principles that every Christian has to know before they can graduate onto a higher level of learning. And I'm going to be informational, instructional, but as I prayed earlier, I pray that it's not only instructional and informational, but the material we declare to you today will be transformational. There are 6 courses that you need to complete before you can even go any farther in God. These are the basics. This is what I call elementary graduation. Anybody here ever have a 6th grade graduation? Or elementary school graduation?
No.
This is just what you need to get through the elementary process of being a Christian. These are simple things that we won't even get into junior high and high school spiritual things if we don't know these 6 things. And sometimes we go on to everything else under the sun and we don't even know the basics. Let me tell you, if you don't know the basics, if you don't have it down in the start, you're never going to get into the higher learning elements. Amen? You can't learn if you haven't had a foundation laid of what you're going to learn. And if you want to examine your life, I want to ask yourself as I preach this word today, God, search me and see if I am an elementary student in the things of God or if I am ready to graduate and move on to a higher level of learning in my life. Make this a practical message in your own heart. The Bible tells me in our text, it says, we are leaving the principal doctrine of Christ, the very first doctrine of Christ, the elementary teachings of Christ. And we're going on to perfection. We're moving forward. Not laying again the foundation of what? The first thing that you've got to have already learned before you can move on is repentance from good works. You need to understand this before you can ever grow in God, that your works won't get you to heaven. That's basic Christianity 101. All that you do in the flesh will do nothing to save your spirit. The Bible said in John 6:63, the spirit quickens, the flesh profits nothing. Amen? And it talks about, let us go on from dead works. Let's turn away from dead works. You can say dead works is equivalent to flesh flesh brings death, the Spirit quickens. Amen? The Bible tells me in Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. How many believe here that you can get to heaven by being a good person? Can I tell you a little secret? Good people go to hell. Saved people go to heaven. Now the problem is this. If you're saved, you better be good. That doesn't say you can be saved and not good. You better be doing, he has showed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of thee? He requires you to be good and to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. Amen? It's not a matter of saying good people can go to hell, I'm saved. Well, if you're saved and you're not good, I don't think you're saved. If you're mean-spirited, nasty, cruel, violent, vicious, rebellious, you're not saved. I'll just say it the way it is. You can go to church on any given Sunday, sit in the pew like any saint that God thinks they can do and get to heaven, but going to church makes you a Christian as much as living in a garage makes you a car or living in a bar makes you a cow. The devil goes to church more than every one of us in this place. He doesn't miss a service. He doesn't miss a chance to mess up what God wants to impart. So don't think that you're holy because you're here every Sunday. You don't know them by their seat assignment. You know them by their fruit. In the book of Galatians chapter 2 and verse number 16. Galatians 2 and verse 16 says this. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. If you turn to the book of Titus, chapter number 3, Titus chapter number 3 and verses 4 and 5. The Bible says this. It said, but after that the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost. He didn't save you because you earned it. He didn't save you because you purchased it. He didn't give you salvation because you were good looking or had an outgoing, charismatic personality. He saved you because of grace. He saved you because of mercy. You cannot purchase your place in heaven. When Adam fell into sin, God created Adam and Eve to live forever. But when sin came, death entered the picture. And when Adam sinned, he knew he sinned. Because the fruit that he partook of was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And when he partook, he realized he had done evil. And when he realized he had done evil, he had enough smarts at that time to understand he needed to do something to reverse the process that just occurred. So what did he and Eve try to do? They begin to go to work. And they begin to make themselves aprons. They begin to sew aprons. They thought their works, they could work by making something happen. And you can't make anything happen on your own. They thought that they could sew together fig leaves and make aprons that would cover their shame and their nakedness and their openness. But when God came down in the cool of the day to walk with Adam, and he found that they were there in the garden covered with fig leaves, their attempt at covering their wrongdoing by the works they did by creating a covering, the apron didn't cover it. So what did God do? He slew an innocent animal, and the blood that was shed that day was what was required that he made them not aprons and fig leaves, but coats, full length, covering the whole thing. And it took the blood sacrifice of an innocent animal, not the works of a fleshly man, to restore and redeem what man had given up. It wasn't Adam's attempt at restoration that brought healing and redemption. It was God's work of redemption that brought restoration. Do you remember after Adam and Eve fell, the next ones on the list were Cain and Abel. And God required something of them. He required a sacrifice. He required an offering. And we know the story how Cain killed Abel. And he killed him. Why? Because he was envious and jealous. Because God had accepted Abel's sacrifice and rejected Cain's sacrifice. God's requirement was not man's works. Cain had given the best of the fruit that he had grown. He had given the best that he could produce on his own. But here was Abel, his brother. Cain was a fruit farmer and a vegetable farmer and a crop farmer. And Abel was a shepherd. And Abel slew an animal and gave that lamb as a sacrifice. Cain came and gave the best that he had. But the best that man has is not what God requires. It is what Jesus does. It was the blood sacrifice of the innocent shed on behalf of the guilty. A foreshadow of the lamb slain from the foundation of the world, Jesus Christ. And all of Cain's good works and all that he had worked to do was not acceptable in the eyes of God. And therefore he was envious at his brother and slew his brother because God accepted what was required, not what was remitted. To obey is better than sacrifice, and all your good works do not get you approval with God. You may impress people by giving money to the poor. You may impress people by doing good works. You may impress man. We have a lot of actors and actresses and philanthropists that want to do good deeds, but their life stinks. They're as immoral and they're as sinful and shameful as you can get, but because they go to Africa or India or Haiti or they go to some poor place and they build something and they give money, the Bible says if I give my body to be burned but I don't have love, it doesn't profit me anything. You see, it's not your works that make the difference. It's your life. Jesus died on the cross, and if our good works got us in right standing with God, then Jesus went to the cross for nothing. It nullifies the work of grace when you rely on works. And the first lesson you need to learn in your Christian walk is your good works will not get you to heaven. If you are still relying on what you do to get you where you need to be, you need to back up, think again. You will do good works because of where you're at. You won't get where you're going because you did what you wanted to do. Second thing you need to learn after you get through the first classroom, then you move on. Move out of the English class, move to the math class, and that is this: if I'm not saved by works, what am I saved by? Faith. The Bible said that we move past this rudimentary teaching of good works and we move toward the faith toward God. When that word faith is written there, it means trust, reliance, or dependence upon. He's referring to a heart faith, not a head faith, not a mental assent, because as we said before, the devil doesn't misinterpret, but even the devils believe God exists. Amen. Remember when Jesus went to the shore of Gadara and there was a man possessed by 2,000 plus demons and they said, we know who thou art, Jesus, thou son of David. We know who you are. We know you're come to torment us before our time. Let me tell you, the devil knows who God is. He's in a war with him right now. So let me tell you a little secret. Just because you believe God exists doesn't mean you are in relationship with God. You need faith. You need to say, God, I trust you so much that I take my hands off the reins and put your hands on. I back off and let you take over. I trust you. I believe you. I know that, God, you can do more for me than I can do for me. And so I step aside so you can step up.
Amen.
That's what faith is. Faith says, go ahead and do what you're going to do, and I won't come in and try to help you do it. difficult for a lot of people. Because when it doesn't get done in the time or in the way or how that person thinks it should be done, they step up and put their hands back on it. I was taught long ago, you've got to give people the opportunity to fail, because if you don't, they'll never learn.
That's right.
Who was telling me yesterday that there was someone speaking in a commencement exercise yesterday, and they said, I'm not going to talk to you about success, I'm going to talk to you about failure, because you'll never understand success unless you fail.
Amen.
That's right.
I rely on you, Lord. It's not my way. You got to let people fail in order for them to succeed. So if you delegate, take your hands off it. Now, as a pastor, I oversee it. That's what a pastor is, an overseer. I watch over. But I try to let the leaders do their part. When it requires me to step in, I will step in. But until that time comes, you've got to allow people. Let me tell you something. You've got to learn how to trust God even greater than that degree. You got to say, Lord, my hands are off it. After all, you created me. I don't know what I'm made of. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made, but I don't know how my circulatory system works. I can study it till I'm blue in the face, but I'm not a doctor. I don't know how my nervous system works. I'm not a psychiatrist. I know certain things about it, but I don't understand. I don't even understand my skeletal structure. I don't know how, God, you could even form bone in the process of creation. How do you take liquid and make solid out of it? I don't even understand that. So how am I going to understand myself? So Lord, I'm learning to trust you because you know what I know. You do what I can. You are what I'm not. Amen? So you got to learn to put your faith in God. You got to say, Lord, it's what you did, not what I do. It's the work that you did on the cross. It is you laying your life down, not me picking my life up. Amen? Not me stepping into the dictatorship and control of my own life, but letting you have control. John 3:16 said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever what? Believeth in him, puts their faith in him, puts their trust in him, should not perish, but have. This is why the world cannot understand Christianity, because when you have to put faith in something, they don't understand faith because they can't prove it scientifically, although the Word of God can be proven scientifically. Amen. And science is more and more proving God's Word true than ever before. But I want you to know, he that believeth on him, he that puts his faith in God, some things you got to take by faith. Some things you are not going to understand because you are not a know-it-all despite what you think you are.
Amen.
The more I learn, the less I know. The more answers I get, the more questions I have. And I want to tell you, this is the way it is with science as well. The more they find answers, the more questions they have to find out how they came to that conclusion. And so their answers create questions. I'm so glad that he is the final say.
Amen.
In the beginning, God. That settles it. Amen. Hallelujah. I am that I am. In Romans 10:9-10, if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart, not our head, but in our heart, that God raised Jesus from the dead, we shall be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. There is a heart faith that has to happen and has to occur if we're ever going to make Jesus Lord of our life and heaven our home. There was a man who had a lot of money, and he came to Jesus and said, good master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus began to quote the law. He said, I've done all that since I was a kid. And Jesus said, you lack one thing. Go and sell all that you have and give to the poor. And the Bible said he went away very sorrowful, for he was very rich. Why? Because his faith was not in Christ. His faith was in money.
Ouch.
Do you know what our young people are taught to put their faith in today? Power, success, finance. You got to be rich. You got to be popular. You got to have what the world says. I want to tell you, I have Jesus, and that's enough. Oh, that's enough. Hallelujah. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son, I feel good today. I feel good because I'm saved.
Amen.
Oh, take this whole world, but give me Jesus. This whole world will give me Jesus. No turning back. How many of these rich millionaires, Aaron Hernandez, just hung himself? How many of these movie stars are taking their lives? Multiplied billions of dollars, successful, very, very well known. I mean, they're popular. They are in the place that everybody wants to be to determine how successful they are, and yet they're killing themselves because their life is empty. Yet we teach our children what you're graduating for is to go on and make money. And the problem is, most of them can't find jobs in the area that they went to school for. And then they're left with debt from student loans they can't afford to pay. And so they go to work at McDonald's because they can't find the job that they wanted to get when they graduated. And now they're in a pickle because we've taught them how to find their self-worth and their success. And when they're not successful at getting what the world told them was success, then they become suicidal and depressed, and they come into society either not contributing or killing themselves. Wow. Am I telling it straight or am I telling it crooked? Here's Noah on the other hand. I mean, here's a rich young ruler trusting in his money, but he went away sorrowful and he was very rich. But now you've got Noah, a preacher of righteousness, and God told him to go build an ark. He didn't know what an ark was. He didn't know what rain was. It never rained before. God says, go build an ark. It's going to rain. He says, build a boat. I don't live near water. And number two, I don't even know what rain is. So what are you talking about? But by faith, Noah began to build. In man's eyes, it was by stupidity. But that's where you trust God, not the flesh.
Yes.
Who was saved? It wasn't his neighbor who mocked him. It wasn't his neighbor who trusted in his own ability to get by. It's a beautiful sunny day, life in the fast lane, doing what I always did. But who was saved and who perished? It was Noah who trusted God and did what God told him to do in spite of what he saw with his eyes. He took by faith the word of God, applied it to his life, and it was Noah that was saved. By grace are you saved through faith. You're not saved by your good works. You're saved by your faith in God. That's the second class you got to go to. The third class you got to go to is this. And again, I'm teaching very basic stuff, preaching very basic stuff. Verse 2 says, of the doctrine of baptisms. People say, what does baptism have to do with Christianity? What does, you know, I had a Bible school student one time who God was using powerfully as an evangelist. He'd come out and read you your life's history without ever seeing your face. God used him in word of knowledge so incredibly. He was in my dad's church. But when we brought him in to minister to the youth, although he was calling people out right and left with specific things, and I've been gifted by God, when we asked him, the youth leader asked him to talk to the kids about water baptism, he said, well, what about it? He didn't have a clue. Let me tell you, if you don't understand what water baptism is about, then you haven't even got past elementary school in the things of God. Why do we baptize people in water? Why do we have this? This is a simple class, a basic class. And I pray it's more than informational, but it's instructional. Do you know that Jesus, before he began ministry, he said to John the Baptist, I must needs be baptized by you. It's a necessity that you baptize me. It's not a request, it's a necessity. I have need that you baptize me. And John said, no, I need you to baptize me. But what happened? That was when the ministry began to start, when Jesus was baptized by John. Why did we have water baptism as one of our standard features in the church? Amen. One of our processes that we go through here. Why? The Bible tells us in Matthew 28 and verse 19, therefore go into all the world, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen?
Amen.
God instructed us that when we bring in new converts and they come into the fold, we baptize them in water. Now, what is water baptism? Does water baptism save your soul? No. Water baptism is simply the outward reflection of an inward relationship. It is an outward declaration of an inward decision. It is showing the world outwardly what God has done with you inwardly. Amen? Acts 2 and 38, 39, Peter said, repent every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ. Repent and be baptized, brother, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promises to you and your children and all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. He said, repent and do what? Be baptized. For the remission of sin. Does the baptism take away your sin? No. Again, it's an outward reflection of an inward condition. It is me telling the world that Christ is my Savior. In Mark chapter 16 and verse number 16, Jesus said, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. Now there's a lot of questions concerning baptism. Why do we get baptized? It is a sign that when I am put under the water and I come up out from the water, that I have been buried with Christ. I'm dead to sin. I died to the old man. And when I come up out of the water, I am risen a new creature. For if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. All things have become new. Paul said, it is no longer I that live, but it is Christ that liveth in me. I died, but Jesus now lives in me. That's what you're saying when you are baptized in water. You're telling the world, I was once a sinner, but I came hardened to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a sinner has come home. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. Now there's an old hymn that half of you never heard. I've died to the old man, and I've come alive to Christ, and I'm telling the world, it is a testimony, it is a public declaration that I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Amen. And I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to him that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Gentile. Amen. I am going to be baptized to let the world know publicly that I have been saved purposefully. Glory to Jesus. Why am I? Now we have arguments over what formula, because in Acts 2:38 says everyone be baptized in the name of Jesus for the remission of sin. But in Matthew it says baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. We have formulas. Do you have to baptize in the name of Jesus, or do you baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost? Well, here at Central Assembly, we baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost because we believe in the Trinitarian God, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and every one of them have a part in the process of your salvation. It was the will of the Father for the death of the Son, and through the drawing of the Holy Spirit, you come to Christ. They're all involved in it. So we baptize in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Ghost. If you get baptized in the name of Jesus, does it make you any less sanctified? No. It's a formula. God's looking at the heart. The reason we do it, I just explained why we do it. It doesn't mean that you're less saved if you get baptized in the name of Jesus. Because if you believe on him, you shall be saved. Amen? But there's a reason we do it. Then we talk about not only the formulas, but we talk about the method. What about sprinkling? Why don't we sprinkle infants here? Because baptism is a declaration that I have died to the old man and come alive to the new. The Greek word baptize is the word baptizo, which means immersion. It means to immerse. And when we immerse, the symbolism is there. The symbolism's not there with those sprinklers. How many know the Word of God is full of symbolism? The Old Testament is typology of the New Testament. And God works that way. Amen? And so there is no symbolic expression in a sprinkling. And besides that, a child cannot make a decision. How can a child be baptized saying, I'm saved, when he's never had an opportunity to admit he was a sinner? So we believe in baptism by immersion. And there's a reason for it, because I am saying I was dead, I am dead to sin, I am alive to Christ. That can't happen for a baby. You have to make a choice. You have to make a decision. The thief on the cross never got baptized. People say you don't have to be baptized to go to heaven. The reason he was never baptized was he died instantly and didn't have an opportunity. The reason we're baptized is because it's a sign of obedience, because God instructs us to do it. And if you have an opportunity to do it and you don't do it, you're disobedient. Plain and simple. The Ethiopian eunuch who got saved out in the desert with Philip, they were going down the road and they came to some water and he said, "There's water, what hinders me from being baptized?" And Philip said, "If you believe with all your heart, then let's do it. If you're a believer, let's do it." He even knew he needed to be baptized. And here he was, an unsaved individual that didn't even understand the book of Isaiah. Had to have it explained to him, but he understood he needed to be baptized. Baptism doesn't save you, but it's an indication you've been saved. Then we move on past the doctrine of baptisms. We move on to this, the laying on of hands. Oh, here's a good one. I was just perusing the internet this past week, and this is from Psychology Today. I know we're not preaching psychology today as the Word of God. I'm just telling you what even the world acknowledges. It says here, 8 reasons why we need human touch more than ever. Even in the digital age, we crave real human contact. Here's why. And this is why a lot of our kids are not developing the way they should, because they have no physical contact. They get online and they have these chats and they have these all kinds of communication over the internet, but there's no human interaction. There is no human interaction. 8 reasons why touch is so important. Number 1, decreased violence. Less touch as a child, they say, leads to greater violence. This is the American Psychological Association telling you the reason there's a lot of violence is because there's not a lot of proper touch. American developmental psychologist James Prescott proposed that the origins of violence in society were related to the lack of mother-child bonding. Child development research indicates that the absence of physical bonding and healthy attachment between an adult and a child may result in lifelong emotional disturbances. Number 2, they say there's greater trust between individuals where there's human touch. Touch helps people to bond together. Daniel Kuytner, the founding director of the Greater Good Science Center and professor of psychology at the University of California, Berkeley, cites the work of neuroscientist Edmund Ross, who found that physical touch activates the brain's orbital frontal cortex linked to the feelings of reward and compassion. According to Kuytner, studies show how a simple touch can trigger the release of oxytocin, and a hormone, it's called the love hormone, and our skin contains receptors that directly elicit emotional responses through stimulation of erogenous zones or nerve endings that respond to pain, according to the research of Aubrey, Mayan, and Spence, whoever they may be. Number 3, there's economic gain. The economic benefits of physical touch, because touch signals safety and trust, it soothes. Basic warm touch calms cardiovascular stress. It activates the body vagus nerve, which is intimately involved in our compassionate response. And they did a research, and I don't know who did this, but they did research and said NBA, National Basketball Association teams, and players who touched each other more won more games. Proper touch, that is. Number 4, decreased disease and stronger immune system. Physical touch may also decrease disease. According to the research conducted at the University of North Carolina, women who receive more hugs from their partners have lower heart rates and blood pressure. Hugs strengthen the immune system. Hugs are better than drugs. Yes.
Stop drugs.
But mister, don't you hug another woman besides your wife? Gentle pressure on the sternum and the emotional charges creates, activates the solar plexus, Chakra that stimulates the thymus gland and regulates and balances the body's production of white blood cells, which keeps you healthy and disease-free. This isn't scriptural stuff. This is what the world's telling us. Say we need touch. People wonder why we had stronger teen dynamics. I'm going to hurry on. I'm going to read all. But non-sexual emotional intimacy, greater learning engagement, overall well-being. And you can read about all this here from the Psychology Today. That's what man says about human touch. And so when they start talking about laying on of hands, God knew what man has tried to figure out long before man ever figured it out. And we, and from a scriptural point, there are two reasons we understand the purpose of laying on of hands. Number one is called identification, and number two is called impartation. Before an Old Testament person who would sacrifice an animal, before they would sacrifice the animal, they would lay their hand on that animal, signifying that animal was taking their place. There was an identification. Oh, he touched me. Oh, he touched me. When he touched me, he's saying, I'm not ashamed of you. I connect with you. We make contact. We're hooked up. We're here together. We are one. Amen? That's identification. And then number two, it's impartation. When the woman touched the hem of his garment, when touch occurred, virtue transferred from him into her. There's a transfer, a transference of anointing when it happens. Bible said in 1 Timothy 5:22, lay hands on no man suddenly, neither be partakers of Christ's suffering of another man's sin. Don't lay hands on people quickly. Be careful who you lay your hands on, because there is a transference. If you go lay your hands on people and you don't know who you're laying your hands on, you may think what you've got going into them, but you got to understand what they've got might be coming into you if you're not strong enough.
Tell it.
Don't just go lay hands on anybody. You better know what you're doing. Amen? And you better know why you're doing it. So we need to understand, first of all, good works won't save you. Number two, faith in God will save you. Number three, we get baptized in water. Why? Because we are telling the world, the old man has died, the new man's alive. These are the basic. And now we get into the laying on of hands. And we don't lay hands on any man suddenly, because there's a transference of what's in you that goes into the other person. If you lay hands on somebody suddenly like this, you're imparting hatred, anger, wrath. But if you embrace and you impart this kind of a touch, you are imparting love, peace, gentleness. You see, the type of touch that occurs is what's transferred into that person. And when you lay hands on people, something is going to connect you together. Remember the woman that we already talked about who said that if I could but touch the hem of his garment, I know I'll be whole, because Jesus said virtue went out of me, dunamis. That which comes in you when you get filled with the Holy Ghost went out of him to heal that woman. It was a transference of anointing. That's why we lay hands on the sick. Mark 16:17-18. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name you will cast out devils. You'll speak with new tongues. You'll take up serpents. And if you drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt you. You shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Why do we lay hands on the sick? Because there's a transferring of what's in us going into them. Peter lifted the man up at the gate, beautiful, and said, silver and gold I have none, but what I have I give unto you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. There is actually a transference of anointing that goes out of the one into the other when we lay hands. If you don't have the Holy Ghost, then you keep your hands off me, Jack. But when I lay hands on somebody, I'm saying the anointing of God that's on my life is not coming into you. I cannot impart a gift or a calling or an office, but I can impart an anointing. God gives the gifts as he will, but the anointing, once he pours it into me, you'll receive power, dunamis, when the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And the word power is virtue. Dunamis, the same as power. What came into me when I got filled with the Holy Ghost is what goes out in to heal the body. And that's why we lay hands on one another. You think it's just some kind of imagery? No, there's more to laying on of hands than just some kind of psychological effect. There is an actual occurrence that takes place of transference and impartation. That's why don't lay hands on any man suddenly, and don't let any man lay their hand on you suddenly. You better know who lays their hand on you before they lay it on you. That's why we have altar workers that we know who up here laying on hands. Amen? Silver and gold I have none, but what I have I give. Not only for healing, but in Acts 19 and verse 6, Paul laid his hand on the church there where he was ministering. And he said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? They said, we haven't heard of any Holy Ghost. And when he laid his hand on them, they received the baptism of the Holy Ghost and began to speak with tongues. Why? Because what he had, he gave. There was a transference. When we pray for people to be healed, we lay hands on them. When we pray for them to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, we lay hands on them. Why? Because there is an impartation that occurs in that instant, and that is why we believe in laying on of hands. Call for the, if any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing with oil in the name of the Lord. Amen. You anoint with oil, you get your finger, hand on there. There's a touch process. Why? Because there's an impartation that occurs. 2 Timothy 1, verse 6. Paul said, stir up the gift of God that is in thee by the putting out of my hands. There is a commissioning, ordination service. And we Mark and Neon, what would be the district council this year? The first night was ordination service, and they ordained new men and women into the ministry. And always in ordination service, they will lay hands on you as an impartation and a commissioning. It is an identification. You're part of us. We acknowledge you. And this impartation of the Lord, go out and do your job. That's why we lay on hands. That's why. Because we are identifying, we are connecting, we are saying, I identify with you, and I'm also putting my stamp of approval and then imparting what I can into your life so that as you go, you are a representation of what I stand for. Amen? Does that make sense? Told you today's going to be informational and instructional, but I pray it's transformational. And maybe some of you didn't really understand why we do what we do here. Why do we baptize in water? Why do we lay on hands? This is basic stuff, but it's graduation weekend, and if you don't learn the basics, you'll never graduate. This is the basic stuff. We got two more classes we got to go to. Are you ready? It says here that we lay aside. But we don't lay again the foundation of repentance from dead works, but we preach faith toward God of the doctrines of baptisms and of laying on of hands and this and resurrection of the dead. We believe that Jesus is the resurrection and the life. He said, he that believeth on me, though he were dead, yet shall he live, and he that believeth on me shall never die. Do you believe this? John chapter 5. And verse number 25, the Bible simply tells me this. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. In chapter 6 and verse number 40, and this is the will of him that sent me, that every one of you which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up on the last day. Hallelujah. 1 Thessalonians 4:16, it says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the trump of God, the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Amen. 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 53, for this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. And there's coming a day where this old body is going to be renewed and rejuvenated and restored and even benefited and blessed and beyond what it ever was on this planet. I look at old photographs and say, hey, I wasn't bad shape at one time. But as my youth pastor in the last church reminded me, Ronald is a shape. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. But I don't care how good your body is Guess what, Art? When you are raised up on that latter day, you're even going to have a different body than you have now. Amen? I'm telling you, nothing's going to compare to the... We are going to be raised from the dead. Hallelujah. This corruptible will put on incorruption. And all my weakness, all my faults, flaws, all of my aches and pains, and all of my bumps and bruises are going to be done away. How do you know we're getting a new body? Somebody shout that loud. Amen. How do you know that when Jesus rose from the dead, he had a new body? Because when Mary saw him outside of the tomb, she didn't recognize him. She thought he was the gardener. She knew his voice, but she couldn't tell his appearance. Because even though she knew him intimately prior, she knew him very well, she was one of the inner circle, she didn't recognize him when he rose from the dead because he didn't look the same. Oh, when you get saved, you look different. Ooh, come on now. When the demoniac got delivered, he was sitting and clothed and in his right mind. He didn't look the way he did before he had an encounter with God. Oh, some of us need to start looking better. But one day, we're getting a glorified body. Amen. All your limitations will be done away with. She didn't recognize him because when they were walking down the road to Emmaus, a stranger joined them. They were talking about their friend, Jesus, the one they put their faith in. And when he joined them, they didn't recognize him. Why? Because he didn't look the same. He had a different body when he came alive out of the tomb. Amen? And when we are caught up to meet him in the clouds, we're not going to have the same body that we once had. He walked through the door. He never knocked on the door. After he was raised from the dead, he just showed up in the room. So evidently, the physical walls didn't keep him from walking through it. And yet, at the same time, he ate fish with them. I don't understand how you can walk through a wall and swallow a fish. That's a different kind of a body than I'm acquainted with. Amen? That tells me I'm going to have the kind of body I can go where I need to be and eat what I want to eat. Amen? Because there's 12 trees with all kinds of fruit, and the leaves are for the healing of the nations, and we're going to eat all manner of fruit. Oh, marriage supper of the Lamb. I'm just getting prepared for it. With all the parties I've been to in the last 2 days, I'm just getting ready for the marriage supper of the Lamb. And I won't gain weight up there. I know I put on about 2 or 3 pounds this weekend, but thank God when I go to heaven I can eat and not sweat. Because when I get to there, there's no more pain. No more death. No more sorrow. No more crying. No more separation. No more sickness. No more heartache. No more tears. What a day that will be when my Jesus, I shall see this old man is going to become a new man. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Your young body is going to become a better body. I want to tell you a little secret. We are going to be raised with him in newness of life.
Amen. Glory.
I look forward to that. I get happy.
Right?
There's one more classroom you got to get through if you're ever going to graduate elementary school and things of the Spirit. You need to know there's a final judgment. We don't talk a lot about this in a lot of churches today, and we wonder why we have spiritual babies in our churches. Because we don't cover the basic in the classes we teach. I want to tell you there's a hell to shun in heaven again.
That's right.
And there is coming a final judgment. That's what the Bible tells me in my text. It talks about the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. Hebrews 9:27 says, it is appointed unto man once to die, and after this the judgment. How many know that judgment is still in God's vocabulary?
Right?
I have a message I preach on that subject. Judgment is still in God's vocabulary. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptation and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. In the book of Revelation chapter 20 is a picture of the great white throne judgment. This is where those who have never accepted Christ, who are in that right relationship, right standing with God, are going to stand in the last days. Verses 11 through 15 declare, and I saw a great that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. The books were opened, the Lamb's book of life. I ran into Pastor Bill Davis at district council, and Bill's a buddy of mine. But when Bill first got saved, I preached a revival up in the North Country. And I've shared in the past, one night three ladies got totally blessed. They were all so drunk in the Holy Ghost, all three had to be carried home. And one was still laughing the next morning when her husband got up to go to work. She laughed all night, the anointing hit her. And God was just moving powerfully. And Bill's wife was one of those three ladies. 10 months after that crusade, I was driving by that church on a Monday morning, and the parking lot was packed out, 10 o'clock Monday morning. I thought, what's going on? They must be in revival. This is a Monday. It's 10 o'clock in the morning. The place is packed out. And 2 weeks after I drove by the church and saw it packed out, I ran into the pastor of that church at the time at a meeting, and Bill was with him. Bill was not in ministry. Bill was a new Christian then. But the pastor, I said, hey, pastor, I said, I drove by your church here a couple weeks ago on a Monday morning. The place was packed to the gills. So you have a revival or what? Oh, no, he said, and he pointed to Bill. He said it was his wife's funeral. I said, I'm sorry to hear that. Bill said, that's all right, Brother Joe. He said, when you came to our church a year ago, my wife and I were new Christians. His wife was one of those three ladies who got so blessed. He said, we didn't know much about God, but we learned a lot that week. He said, about a month ago, my wife became sick. He said, and we thought she had the flu, and we took her to the hospital. But when they got in there, she was full of cancer, and within 2 weeks, she was dead, 36 years old. He said, I have three daughters. My youngest is 11 years old. And he said, the other night, she came to me. She was weeping. She was crying. She was sobbing. She said to me, she said, Daddy, sure miss my mommy. It's always worse at night because she always tucked me in and read me a story. And I miss my mommy. He said, Brother Joe, I didn't know what to say to my daughter. I'm struggling with the death of my wife. How do I help her get through the death of her mother? And I stumbled, I thought, I tried to find something to say, but before I could respond, she spoke up again and she said, but Daddy, Daddy, it's okay. She said, I went to bed the other night, and when I closed my eyes to go to sleep, I saw a book. Mama's name was written in it. I know everything's all right. He said, Brother Joe, my daughter didn't know anything about the Lamb's Book of Life. That night, God gave her a glimpse of eternity. And if your name is not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, heaven is not your home. If your name is not recorded in God's registry, you are not going to live with Him. How many have ever witnessed, either in person or on TV, a trial at which all of the horrendous acts of violence, perversion, cruelty, and selfishness were rehearsed? If you've witnessed that, you can get a glimpse of the final judgment. But it's not going to be, the scene is not going to be repeated for one single crime, for one single sin. But all the cruelty, the violence, the perversion, the sickness of your sin is going to be exposed for every sin you have ever committed as you stand before Him on that day. All of the hidden acts are going to be shouted from the rooftop. And then He's going to, with tears in His eyes, not with laughter on His face because He doesn't want to do this, but with tears streaming down His face and sadness in His heart, going to say, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. I never knew you. I never knew you. And yet one drop our name is not written in the Lamb's book of life, and his blood is not blotted out our sin, every wretched, rancid, rotten sin we have ever committed is going to be exposed and revealed. And then you'll be evicted from the presence of God to live with the one you love, Satan. The verdict is either going to be gruesome or glorious. You're either going to be saved or you're not. And when that verdict is read and the sentence is revealed, it's over. It's the final judgment. Two men lived and two men died. One man was very rich and very wealthy, and he lived to satisfy self. He did what he wanted to do and had no regard for Jesus Christ. He never repented of his sin. He just continued in sin because he had the wherewithal to do whatever he wanted, whatever he chose. But the other man, his name was Lazarus. And this isn't a parable. It's not a story. This is the account of an actual happening, because in parables, names were never used. But Jesus names Lazarus. Lazarus was a beggar who sat at the feet of Jesus, or not the feet of Jesus, but he followed Jesus. He lived for God. And he'd sit at the foot of the rich man and take the food that fell off the table and eat it. But they both died, because I don't care if you're rich or poor, saved or unsaved, every one of us is going to die. It's appointed another man wants to die. Death is the one appointment you can't escape. You can't outrun it. You can't cancel the appointment. You can't ignore it. You can't buy your way out of it. Every one of us is going to die. There's an after that. And after that, the rich man went straight to hell. And Lazarus, the Bible said, went to paradise. And in hell, he lifted up his eyes and he said, "Oh, send somebody to dip their finger in water and touch my tongue, because I'm in torment in this place." And Jesus said, "Listen, you had Moses and the prophets, you didn't listen to them, and now there's a great gulf fixed between you and us. We can't come to you, and you can't come back. It's over. There's no purgatory, Jack. According to the Word of God, purgatory is not an option. Soul sleep is not the issue. I want to tell you, when you die, you live. The only question